Hi, everybody. Welcome to your weekly broadcast. Lee Honnish, David Bartels, bringing you the wonderful world of real estate trends. I am joined by always as the CEO of Everhome.io, David Bartels. How are you today, David?
I'm good, thank you. How are you?
I'm great.
I'm calling in from a random hotel room in Walnut Creek, California.
I'm calling in from a random room in my house. I feel like my new place, I got to find a better backdrop than a white wall and a light underneath me. Yeah. I had the backdrop before. I've had multiple cool backdrops. This one's very white. So I'll work on that for the next week. For those of you joining for the first time, we talk about real estate trends, what's going on in the wonderful world of real estate. As always, this show, as well as this coaching call, is sponsored by Everhome. Visit everhome.io. David, please share with everyone what Everhome is all about.
Well, Everhome is a really exciting project that we're undertaking. What we've done is we're allowing consumers to leverage technology to sell their home in the same way buyers are using technology to buy a home. And you can check it out at everhome.io. It's really very cool, and we're very excited about it. It's just launched a week ago.
Excellent. This show is about real estate trends, so let's talk about some of those real estate trends. This is the interesting thing to me, David. I am kind of obsessed about this at the moment. Real estate, for those of you who don't know, prices are going up. There are people speculating that prices are going to go down. People are worried about the election. People are worried about the interest rates going up. It's either here nor there. We're going into the winter months. I don't think that will have a great effect on real estate in general, David. So let's start right there. Now we're going into fall and winter pricing, which in California doesn't mean anything. It actually boosts real estate sales because now it's actually cooler in the rest of the country and warmer out here. So I expect for California trends, the prices to continue going up at this point.
For sure. I mean, at the end of the day, especially California, real estate is really driven based on supply. And no matter what's happening outside a door, we still have a limited supply and there's plenty of demand. And the result is prices continue to inch up.
Simple as that. For those of you in the rest of the country, this is now the time of the season when sales start to decline due to the weather and things of that nature. So you want to keep an eye on that. The one trend that I find really interesting, which we've seen sporadically since the start of COVID, is people trying to adapt and go online. And I want to focus on that a little bit today because that's a part of your marketing strategy. It's definitely what I'm into. So let's talk about this. For everybody who's on the call here live at the bottom of the hour, we'll be doing questions. I'll actually stay on and do some web shots and some live stuff. If you'd like to be a part of the live call, go to coachingcalls.info and you can get all of our back issues, episodes, everything we've ever done. With all of that said, David, let's talk about content-based marketing, right? For literally a year, it was almost like a hypothetical thing in the world of real estate, right? We believed we could out-knock the front door. We could send mailers. I remember distinctly November, I got a call because I do free consultations on marketing. And a guy called me up and he explained to me how he was going to do mailers and that he had it explained to him by the mailing companies that they were back on the trend. This is pre-COVID. Now I might say yes, but back then it was unheard of. And we had been professing for quite a while working on online-based content, branding your product and going from there. So let's start there. You've now probably been doing content for close to 2 years, I want to say.
Easily
2 years, right? And it is something that I just push through the front door. I do podcasts. I do videos. So let's start right there. When it comes to doing content for you, what do you see getting better action, you as a broker? Is it content about your individual houses or virtual walkthroughs, or do you see a better response from just content based, right? Like about the market, your little market updates, because you do short little market updates. What have you seen works the best for you?
Well, what I see works best is what I refer to as information-based technology-assisted content. I mean, because that's the way people want to do business. If you think about the way most people are buying products today or researching products, it really starts, they're gathering information. Yeah, there's referrals and that kind of thing. But at the end of the day, even when you go to select a restaurant, what do? You go on the TripAdvisor, you go on the Yelp, you see what's around there, you filter it by the number of stars, you read a few reviews, and you call or click to, you know, make a reservation, or you share it with somebody first and say, hey, what do you think? And then you end up making a reservation. People like to gather information and then, you know, actually make a decision. They don't, and that's the same thing when it comes to real estate. When people are looking to make any kind of real estate decision, whether or not it's buying or selling, at the end of the day, most people, we know 93% of buyers are going online and using the internet to do research and to identify the homes that they want to look at, versus waiting for their realtor to disclose to them what homes they might want to look at. So people want to gather the information. They want to do that research on their own. They don't want any pressure. And if they need more information they can get, or they want, or they need help with the critical elements of the transaction, maybe they need lockbox access, that's when they engage the realtor from the buy side of the technology. On the sell side of the transaction, what's happening is that people are simply researching what agents they should do. They're researching what prices are in their neighborhood based on recent activity, but there isn't yet until now, I guess, technology to help them do that. So from my perspective, I think anything informational that helps people understand what's going on in the market, what options that are available to them, what different ways of engaging with agents, what those engagement options are, I think is really good content. So people just want to consume information and make a well-informed decision based on that information.
I completely agree. I think the biggest thing that I've seen, especially when creating content for people, is especially audio, right? There is like this myth that you can do radio stations or you can do podcasting. And it seems to me that ingrainment isn't a real word, but that's really the word I'm looking for. There's this weird ingrained attitude of still always be selling, even when it comes to creating content for someone. And it's very frustrating for me, especially when I listen to, let's use the example, local radio, the Saturday morning real estate show or the Saturday morning mortgage show. It seems to be pushing more towards the sale all the time instead of bring valuable content. I've been watching, especially people I know lately online, creating content and live videos, and they're starting to integrate it into their daily lives. Let's talk about this from the content to the sales side. I think there's a time and a place to push for a sale always. I prefer to teach and profess, wait for them to ask you instead of always be selling. And I see people incorporate that always be selling into their, hey, hire me, hire me, hire me, hire, ooh, ooh, hire me. By the way, here's a person who sets up houses, hire them. I don't think that that's the way to go about it. I think bringing valuable content to people will benefit in the long run. And I'd like to hear your experience.
Well, I think that's absolutely true. When a potential client is looking for an agent, whether or not they're buyers or sellers or both, they're really looking for somebody they can trust. They're really looking for somebody who can has demonstrated expertise. And you got to look at this content as building a relationship with them, sharing valuable information. And once they start to consume your information, You may not even know they're consuming your information. And then the next thing you know, you're getting a phone call and saying, hey, I watch all your videos, or I really appreciate the articles that you post online, that kind of thing. And next thing you know, you've got a non-competitive appointment with them. And I say non-competitive because you're the only one they called. They didn't call three agents and have them come out and do an interview. They called you and only you because they had already established a trusted relationship with you based on the consistent content that you were developing that was educational in nature.
Right. I completely agree. I think that most people in real estate, and I use a broad term, but I've just, ever since I saw the virtual NAR conference and everybody pushing for it's about being online, it's about creating content, it's now starting to push real estate agents into that world. And I would hope that the point of the message that I'm trying to get across, because we talked about this 2 weeks ago on a trend basis, is that valuable content will create expertise just by being online. And I know people don't believe this, just by creating a podcast, by creating a video, by taking the video and putting it individually into groups for a local area that you're working in, will create expertise for you. And the repetitive model of constantly putting out market updates, here's a house that I sold recently, here's what's going on in the area, hey, here's a great bakery. If you're branding yourself and you're repeating the process, you're creating ultimately a brand in the long run. And that's something you've strived. I kill myself on words.
I don't know.
One of those. But that was a big part. That was a big part of your big 2 year push of branding yourself as a broker, right? You've experimented with interviews in the local area. You've done market updates. You constantly put out the market information. And I get this a lot, especially with people I work with and create content for. Well, I only got like 20 or 30 people to watch it. Well, that's 20 or 30 people who didn't know anything about you before today. Okay. Stop getting caught up in being a viral sensation. Yeah. Viral sensations happen on all forms of on all the platforms, but more than likely, it's not a baby eating an ice cream cone out of a chipmunk's hand or something. I mean, that's what goes viral. Yeah. This is about very targeted groups of individuals to better your business. So I'd like to hear your experience in the move towards that.
Well, you know, I don't think that what you're going for is viral. I mean, obviously, if you're going to do the work, you know, to create content like this call, you know, I don't know how many people listen to what we're doing, but we're not trying to conquer the world. We just want to reach one person. So if you're a real estate agent and you and your content gets introduced to 20 new people a month, let's just say, not yep. No big deal, 20 new people a month. And one of those people are going to do a transaction in the next couple of years. That means within 2 years, you've picked up another 12 transactions a year. It's not, you know, it's a cumulative effect. You don't see the impact right away. It's, you know, I say this maybe every podcast, is that one in 95 adults in California has a real estate license. If you've got 500 Facebook friends, that's five real estate agents. Which one are you going to choose? The one who's got demonstrated expertise, you know, who's got demonstrated success, or the one that's, you know, that's a kind of a casual real estate guy, does it once in a while? Who do you want to handle the biggest financial transaction you've probably ever done up until that time in your life? Just somebody you're buddies with, or somebody who knows what the heck they're doing? And this is why I say, The whole thing about content marketing is to solve the number one problem that I find that real estate agents have, and that is they're secret agents. Nobody knows that they're agents. Nobody knows that they're doing well. Nobody knows that they've got this expertise because they're not making any effort to share it in a consistent basis that adds value to the potential relationship.
Yeah, I completely agree with you. And I think even from a bigger standpoint, which I find fascinating as well, is not targeting their message. So you make a great video, you do a market update, and you put it out primarily on Facebook. I'm not saying that there isn't a place on Instagram or Google or any of those. I'm just telling you my personal experience when it comes to lead sourcing. Facebook consistently is by far the best, by far, hands down the best. And I've paid for Google ads. I've paid for everything. David, you literally pay for your leads, right? Let me reframe that. You don't pay for your leads. You pay for your targeting, right? But you don't spend more than $4 or $5 when you actually target out one of your pieces of content.
Yeah. So we don't, when you say, you know, I want to just clarify, we don't buy leads from Zillow or homes.com or anything like that. But what we do sometimes is we sometimes buy data, and even less of that right now. So most of what we're doing is basically clickbait, either on Facebook or pay-per-click, pardon me, to direct those people into, you know, to our website and into our CRM, at which point we have a pretty aggressive follow-up with them. So, you know, where I'm spending the money is not as much on the lead generation. That represents, you know, a few thousand dollars a month. Where I end up spending the money is on the inside salespeople, the showing agents, the salespeople, you know, the marketing people. That's really where we're doing. I spend my money on the conversion of the lead. Okay, that's really what I am focused on. Now, you know, I've got employees in the Philippines. I get it at a little lower cost. But when I'm targeting a for sale by owner, I used to buy that data from Red X, and we've experimented with some other ones, and we just found it just wasn't that good. And the best source of information is Zillow. So I've got people, you know, I've got three people every day that spend all day looking for new for sale by owners and inputting them in our database, applying an action plan, distributing them to inside sales people who then start doing outreach and emails and, you know, phone calls and texting to them. And when we get somebody that's interested in learning more, then they go to a licensed agent who then closes the deal and, you know, puts them through. And we're literally listing houses over the phone in 20, 30 minute conversations. It's the most remarkable thing that I've ever seen. But the technology makes it possible. But I spend more money on lead conversion. And the best advice that I think I could ever give anybody, whether or not you're in real estate or not, you're just in the lead generation business, is that there is no greater waste of money than to generate leads that you're not going to follow up on and convert. I mean, if you don't have a solid conversion process, you should stop, spend your money on building your conversion process, lower your ad budget if you don't have a solid conversion. More leads is not better. Converting leads is what it's all about. And so, for instance, I was almost late for this call because I was online with, one of our marketing people who we were having this conversation. And it's so important, even though I'm out of town and I'll be backed up when I get back to the office tomorrow, I asked him to block 2 hours on my schedule so he and I could stop what we were doing. We need to stop everything, fix this challenge that he's having, make sure the action plans are and the follow-up process is in place so that we can keep going. That's really how important it is. So you're better off to have a little marketing budget and a bigger conversion bucket, you know, in terms of money, than you are a big marketing budget and no time or help converting those leads.
Yeah, I can agree with that. One of my personal frustrations, as someone who's I have been brought in multiple times throughout the years to improve the workflow of a real estate office. And it's amazing to me when I meet with a broker who says, I should be having more business. Well, yeah, generally speaking, yes. And when you start to map out the flow, right? And I would recommend this for anybody, just take a whiteboard and go from here's where I get the most of my leads, here's what I do next, here's what I do next. Just write it out. Keep it as simple as possible. Right. I can't tell you how many times I've met with a broker who looks at me really frustrated after paying me a large sum of money to sit there and go, there's your problem right there, and there's the leak, and that'll be all for me. What are you talking about? You're leaking right at this point. Like, you have the number of leads you think you should have, but people are cherry picking the leads. They're not following up on the leads. You should have a phone list. We can't even get to the next step until you plug the leak and every single phone number. I've seen it repeatedly. This has gone on for a decade of me consulting with some of the largest brokerages, where they go, gosh, I think we should have way more listings than this. You're right. You should have more buyers than sellers. If you got 100 signs out on the boulevard, you should be getting more phone calls. There's something wrong.
Right. So that's exactly right. So what's happening, I think that people, the number one plague that real estate people are facing is this need for immediate gratification. That a lead's either ready now or they're not. And if they're not, all right, there's no organized plan to follow up with them in most cases. There's no consolidation of those leads anywhere so that they can give themselves a reminder. What in the old days when I was starting out, we didn't have CRMs, we had tickler files. I remember I had a little one of those little plastic index boxes that had the numbers 1 through 30 and then the dates, and I wrote all of my leads on 3x5 index cards, and I would write their name and their contact. And then the way that it worked in those old days, I'm really dating myself, I haven't thought about this in a long time. If I was supposed to call somebody on the 15th, I would take their 3x5 card and I'd move it behind the 15th. And every day I'd go and pull out all the cards for the 15th, and I would call and follow up with them. You know, we didn't have texting. We had answering machines back then. That was high tech back in, in the day. And, and if I wasn't supposed to call somebody for 3 months, then they'd go, I put them in the January, file. And then January comes, I'd pull them up and, start calling them. You need that same, I knew way back then, that was before I knew anything. I knew way back then that selling anything wasn't really about you're either ready or you're not. And then if you're not, then next, that some will, some won't, so what next mentality. And basically, if someone's not ready to do a transaction in 6 months to a year, which is pretty typical when you talk to somebody, my response is no problem. I'm going to need the deal in a year or two. And so I put them in an electronic tickler file. We call it Follow Up Boss now. And we write notes about what happened. And then we give ourselves a task to follow up. And in the meantime, we'll send them a couple of emails that are sent automatically to remind them that we're alive, and we track their activity. And if they get active, we might call them sooner. But for the most part, people don't fall through the cracks when they have an action plan. And what I beat into everybody's mind is, what's the next logical task? And have you recorded the date that you're going to do that? And that's what we do. I end every conversation with clarifying the next logical task, which means if I were talking to you as a prospect, Lee, I might say, okay, well, that all sounds good. What do you think the next logical step is for us here? And then you would tell me, and I say, okay, great, that's what we'll do.
Right.
And then I do it.
To that point, so you go to the trouble of and I saw this with a friend recently. And I've been quiet. It's really hard with friends to quietly coach them. That's kind of my little angst in life. But why isn't your phone number on your stuff? Why aren't you giving yourself a chance? Do you think that this is going to work? You're not sharing the message. You're not spending $5 to put it out to your market. You're not putting it in the local groups. You're just basically building content to build content that's going nowhere. So you got to build these funnels. You've got to get the information. You got to try to get a phone number. I'll go straight to that point. I've been doing the monster now since 2010, if anybody wants to keep track with that, from San Diego all the way to LA. I have a phone list. I call it the once a year call from San Diego to LA. I still use Sly Broadcast. I say, hey, do you or someone you know need help still with their short sale or whatever? I keep it very basic and very plain depending on my mood in the day. Please feel free to refer them if I've worked for you. If I've met with you previously and you need help, give me a call. Every year I send that message out to the same list, even the people that I've helped. I'm not doing rocket science, and I always get one or two calls that say, oh, I forgot that I met with you, and yeah, well, it fell through, and now with COVID, I'm coming up on that date again. I guarantee I'll get a couple of leads again. It's the repetition of those models. It doesn't matter if I'm doing online funneling. I saw this with the leads that I was creating off of Facebook. You're getting phone numbers of buyers. Why aren't you calling them all and trying to get them qualified? Well, I'm looking for people who are ready right now. I agree with you, David. Do you want
too.
A deal today or do you want a deal a year from today? And the answer is yes.
Yeah, me too. I mean, everybody's looking for those, and you find those once in a while. I mean, at the end of the day, it is a numbers game. But for the most part, real estate is about nurturing relationships. It's really about trusted relationships. I mean, listen, in spite of, you know, the incredible technology that we've developed to allow sellers to literally go in 15 minutes, list their house online, okay, themselves for, you know, and get full service professional representation for the critical elements of negotiation and paperwork and legal disclosures and escrow and title and those kind of things that good real estate agents do for their clients and do it for, you know, for less than $3,000. You know, people say, oh, real estate agent's going to hate you. And I'm like, why? Because even with, in spite of that, we might get 1% of the market, maybe 1% of the market. At the end of the day, what most people still want is still about trusted relationships. It's real estate is still about trusted relationships. The likelihood is somewhere in the 70% range that a person is going to select an agent based on somebody they already have a relationship with, period. And it has nothing to do with their level of skill. I could be the most skilled, most experienced real estate agent in the planet, but if you're, you know, and you may have not done a transaction for 3 years, and they may be comparing me against you, but you happen to be their dearest friend of many years, I'm not getting that deal, and you can be charging them 5% to do it versus my $3,000. I'm not getting that deal because it's the trusted relationship, unless you say, don't choose me, you should go to that other guy, they'll do a better job for you than me. I'm otherwise not getting that deal. So it's still a relationship business. We're not putting Keller Williams out of business. We're not putting Compass out of business. We're not putting anybody out of business. We're just giving consumers another alternative. And relationships are still going to be the most important thing that real estate agents have. And social media content and content in general is the most effective way for you to develop those relationships, even with people that you have limited contact with throughout the year.
I completely agree. And I'll give you guys the math on it. To really cultivate a lead, the math is very simple. 5 to 15 times. That's the average touch rate. What's a touch? They got a video, they got an email, they got a phone call. Rinse, repeat. I don't care if you start the lead online with good content, if they were kind enough, and I say this, if they're kind enough to give you an email address or a phone number, give them more content long before you give them a sales pitch. It will pay off in the long run. David, give them information on Everhome.
Well, just you can learn more about Everhome at everhome.io. It's a really exciting platform. It'll explain the entire program to you. And if you have a house you want to list for $450 up front in the multiple listing service, and then have us handle the negotiations and paperwork, the critical elements for $2,500 to close of escrow, it's the way to go. Everhome.io will give you all the information.